Good morning. Welcome to church. It's great to come to you again in your lounge rooms, and we're really grateful that you're tuning in and watching along with us this morning. We're going to have a great morning this morning. We're coming towards the end of our Ephesians journey, and so we're going to hear from Simon Aubrey this morning from Ephesians chapter 6, and we're really looking forward to that. Before we do, though, I wanted to take some time to bring you an exciting announcement. I hope you find it exciting. Anyway, we're really excited to announce that we have filled the role of youth ministry leader after Laura has gone on maternity leave, and we've spent a bit of time praying and interviewing and planning ahead, and we've finally come to our new youth ministry person, or should I say persons. In actual fact, we're really excited to announce that we've been able to put on from our youth ministry leadership, AD Murphy and Josh Shaw. They're each going to do a day a week, and they're going to support our youth, and they've been part of our youth ministry for quite some time already, and so they're going to continue to do youth ministry, and particularly through this COVID season. And in a few moments, I'll get a chance to show you a pre-recorded interview with them, and you can get to know them just a little bit. But we're really excited about that. We believe that God has led us to this, and that God is with them, and that there's going to be a real opportunity to take care of our youth through this season of COVID, and also begin to plan and dream for the future. So that's really exciting, and get behind them, pray for them, send them a little note of encouragement. We'd love to hear from you, and particularly to hear your words of prayer and encouragement for them. That'd be fantastic. So now we're going to watch the interview with AD and Josh, and you'll have just a few moments to get to know them, and looking forward to hearing what you have to say about that.
Well, g'day, Josh and AD, and welcome to Zoom Church, and a little intro of you guys. So glad you could both join with us. And we thought really the purpose of this conversation today will be just to get to know you a little bit, since we can't meet you in person, face-to-face. This is the best that we can do. So I thought I'm just going to fire away a couple of questions at you, not 20, don't worry, and not too scary questions, but hopefully they'll be questions that just help us have a bit of a vibe of who you are. So first question, it's very important to me. As you can see, I like lovely colours. Can you see my jacket? What is your favourite colour? I'll start with you, Josh.
Favourite colour. It's always been the same all through my life, and it's blue. I don't know why, it's just a nice colour. But I also like white and black, but people call them shades. So, yeah, got to go with blue.
Not really a colour. That's nice. Dark blue or light blue? It doesn't matter.
Typically, darker blues are my preferred. But All blue's good in my eyes.
Very good. Do you have a not favourite? Like an anti-favourite?
Or my least favourite? I don't know. Controversial. I'm probably going to say purple. I know a lot of people like purple, but I don't know. Not for me.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. What about you, Ada? Got a favourite colour or a not favourite colour?
But isn't purple like blue?
It's, I know, it's weird. It's similar, but no, it's not blue.
That's all I'm thinking about now. I don't really have a favourite colour. I like all colours equally, I think. I don't know, I never really had favourites. I was always that kid that said rainbow was my favourite colour, and it sounds like a cop-out, but it's really not for me.
Well, all the years I've known you, Ada, you've been very colourfully dressed. So I think you do represent all the colours, not just one. That's fair enough. Cool. How long have you been involved in Emerge? I'll start with you, Josh, again.
So I've only been officially involved in Emerge for the start of this year. But I've been active in SYG for like 6+ years with Emerge. And I've also come and helped out on a few summer camps over the years. But yeah, officially involved just the start of this year.
A long association, but more officially this year. Before that, you were leading youth somewhere else. Do you want to say a few words about that?
Yeah, sure. Before jumping on board with Emerge, I was leading at Lilydale Baptist Church for, I don't know, at least five years, running small groups and different activities with them. So that was a good time.
But, been doing youth group for a long time in youth min.
Many years now.
And your connection to Emerge, how did you connect with us?
Yes. The connection point was through one Kate Alexander. So she's my cousin, and she told me about her church and all the fun things they do. So I came along to SYG and then eventually found the people here really cool in the community. So I thought I'd come along to more things and eventually got completely roped in, as you can now see.
Sounds wonderful. And we're the better for it. What about you, Aidy? How long have you been involved with Emerge?
I'm trying to think. I should have been counting the years, but I wasn't. Similar to Josh, I've been involved with Emerge through SYG for quite a few years. And similar to Josh, I was also roped in, but by my sister, for, yeah, the exact same reason. I remember one year she came back from SYG and she was, like, raving about it. So the next year I wanted to go, and that would have been 8 years ago maybe. Yeah. And I've just been part of Emerge. I would join every now and again for a few good events, but mostly just so when I was around for SYG, I wasn't an unfamiliar face. So I committed to the youth team the start of last year, and so I've been leading all of last year. And so as you can see now, I've kind of stepped into a more higher role, so that's exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. And really great to have you on board. And you're studying theology at the moment, is that right?
Correct. I'm loving it. I have a bit of a love-hate relationship, but it's mostly love.
I think every student of theology feels the same sometimes. That's great. Alrighty. What do you enjoy about youth ministry? Either of you can answer this. What are some of the things you like most about it?
Where to start? There's lots of things to like about youth ministry. The young people, obviously, pretty key. I love seeing them grow, develop, figure out what life has in store for them, and learning what God has in store for them. Mm. Getting to know young people, helping them grow. And you have so much fun while doing it. So that's really what the main things I love about youth ministry.
That's fantastic. Some people would say, oh my gosh, working with teenagers must be so difficult. But it sounds complete opposite to you. It's the great joy of working with young people, the fun of that, and the adventure of learning together. Yeah, it's cool. What about you, Aidy?
Again, I should have spent more time thinking about this. But I guess, like, for me, I really like giving young people a chance and showing them unconditional love and caring for them when it might not be something that they're used to. Yeah. Yeah, I feel like that's part of the main reason I love youth ministry, is also like giving them an example and an opportunity to be a little bit weird, to be a little bit crazy. Teenagers often, I mean, myself included, even now, like, you look about, like, you care about how you look and whether you look cool. But in reality, like, we're all just big dorks, and I love being able to be a part of that craziness.
That's fantastic. I started ministry doing youth ministry, and I thought I would never move out of it. I loved it so much. Love working with young people, and I'm so excited that you guys love that and love supporting young people in their adventure, their faith journey and their life journey. I think it's such an important ministry. So great to hear what you love about it. All right, tell us something we should know about you. Just so we can say, yeah, I know Josh, or yeah, I know Aidy. And then we need to know this about you to really know you.
Okay. Well, yeah, there's a few things. I'm pretty mad obsessed with basketball. I love my basketball. I'm also a sucker for a really good quote or a good speech. Anything that gets me motivated like that. So I often look up inspirational speeches on YouTube before I do study or something, just to get me in the mood. That's something, I guess.
That's fantastic. What's your favorite speech?
That's a tough one. There's so many good ones. I'm a sucker for a good speech from Lord of the Rings, any of the battle speeches, or something that Gandalf says.
You'll fit right in at staff meeting every now and then. When we go for a speech, we pull out one and we have to work out where in the movie it was. So that sounds like fun. Good to hear. All right, Aidy, what do we need to know about you to really know you?
I really, really like music, like, a lot. I think I'm slightly going insane in lockdown because I haven't been able to see live music. I think that's something that's really important to me.
Can you sing music?
Pardon?
Can you play music? That's my fingers on the piano.
Oh, no, sorry. I can't see because you're hiding through my basket.
I know you can sing. Can you play music and instrument?
Yeah. When I was a teenager, I played so much more because I had more time, but I've recently been jumping back into playing guitar with my free time, so that's been really fun. I also dabble on the ukulele when I get a chance.
Awesome. Well, I look forward to hearing some of that in the future. And I know you've led in some of our worship services and Christmases and things, so we look forward to having you as part of that. Hey guys, it's been so great just to have a moment to get to know you. We know over the next few months we'll get to know you a whole lot more. And we also will be praying for you. So please know that as you begin this adventure, that your church is behind you. And I'm just going to take a moment to pray for you and bless you, and then I'll let you go. Lord, I want to thank you so much for AD and for Josh. I want to thank you so much for their willingness to take up this call and challenge to lead Emerge Youth through this season. And as Laura has left on maternity leave and they're stepping in to serve our young people, we thank you for the history and the heritage of already serving and loving young people. And we thank you that you've prepared them even now for such a time as this. We look forward to all that you will do through them. We pray that you will bless them, that you will anoint them with your Holy Spirit presence and power and wisdom and love and grace. And we pray, Lord God, that our young people will continue to grow to love each other and to love you, Jesus, more through this season. And so we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thanks so much, team. Really appreciated catching up with you. Take care.
Thanks, Becky.
Well, hopefully you enjoyed that little snippet of information about AD and Josh and feel like you're starting to get to know them a little bit. Now we're going to enter a time of prayer as we prepare our hearts for worship. You know, the scripture says to pray at all times in all kinds of prayer. And so as we come to worship, as we come to communion, as we come to learning from God this morning, we want to be prayerfully ready. So let's join together in prayer. Lord, we thank you for your instruction and invitation to come and to pray to you at all times with all kinds of prayer. And God, we thank you that prayer is simply talking to you. That's as simple as it is, but as amazing and wonderful and mysterious as it is too, talking to the God of the whole universe. This morning we welcome your holy presence with us. We gather together in the name of Jesus. He is our Lord, and we thank you that he is with us as we do so. We offer ourselves to you this morning in worship. Whatever we've come from, whatever's going on in our life, in this time, we set ourselves aside to worship you, to lift our eyes to you, to lift our hearts to you, to renew our trust in you, and to remember who you are, and to invite you to continue your renewal work in our hearts. So, Lord, we declare you as Lord, our Lord, Lord of the church, Lord, even over this earth, and we pray, Lord God, that you will do your mighty thing today as we worship and as we learn. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, have a wonderful service. Enjoy yourself. Grow. Continue to respond. Give us feedback. We'd love to hear from you. We're wishing you God's peace.
Now and into our homes today. We love you, God. We want to build your kingdom now with you.
Thanks for joining us today, wherever you might be, to share in this time of communion. Last year at this time, I celebrated my birthday while touring the Kimberley region. It was a day full of happy memories, except for one. I dropped Rita's camera. And although it was take photographs, the back LCD screen did not display anything. I recently decided to repair the camera. And to this end, I watched various YouTube videos, found the necessary part, and when I received it, I laid everything out on the bench and away I went. This is what I removed. I couldn't see any damage until I held it up to the light and looked closely. I then saw a few cracks and something had run between the panes of glass. It reminded me of how our lives must look to God. It is only when we shine the light of Christ into our lives that we see the cracks and the runs of liquid and whatever it is that hold us back from being people we were created to be. God wanted to fix this problem, not by replacing the defective parts as I did with the camera, but by making them clear so that we can operate seeing the cracks that have developed in our lives. To this end, he sent his son into the world. Jesus prepared the people to live with their cracks and to work with their flaws. He shed his light onto them so that they were visible. Many did not like what they saw, so they turned against him, while those close to him were beginning to understand what he was actually doing. Jesus knew that what was going to happen to him, his betrayal, cruel death on the cross, and his resurrection. He knew that he was not going to be with his disciples forever, and so he wanted to prepare them for that time, because they were going to be his light shining in the world. It is now our time to be prepared, and so we share together, just as the disciples did all those years ago. In the sharing, we remember who and what we are. We remember the love and light that is given for us, faults and all. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took two simple items from the table of his last meal. The first was bread, which after giving thanks, he tore apart as a reminder of the way his body would be torn apart, and gave it to his disciples, explaining this, and asking that they do this in remembrance of his sacrifice. In the same way, we take the bread and remember. Will you eat with me? He later took a cup of wine as a reminder of the blood he was about to shed, and after giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, explaining that the cup is a new agreement between God and humanity. He asked they drink it in remembrance of him. In the same way, we take the cup and remember. Will you drink with me? Please pray with me. God of love, God of mercy, God of grace, give thanks for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who came into the world to shine his light on us, allowing us to see what it is in our lives that has been and may be separating us from being in a loving relationship with you. We give thanks that after exposing our cracks and flaws, we are not turned away, and that despite them, we have been welcomed into your family. We give thanks that through the sacrifice of your Son, we have been given the opportunity to work through these cracks and flaws in our lives, drawing us ever closer to being the people we were created to be. We also give thanks for the simple meal that we have just shared together in our own way, for the meaning behind the two simple elements, and how they remind us of your deep love for each and every one of us. These things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, the Saviour of humanity. Amen.
Welcome to church this morning. It's so great to be with you here today in this space. We've spent the last number of weeks looking at the book of Ephesians, Paul's letter to this small group of Christians in the city of Ephesus. And it's important for us to keep in mind that when we're hearing this letter from Paul to the community at Ephesus, that this is a really small group of people that find themselves in this space at this time. They were a community on the edges. They were on the fringes of society. As they worshipped Jesus, as they recognized him as Messiah, the ancient world merely tolerated their presence. They weren't really encouraged. They just kind of were put up with. The life of the early Christian community was not really encouraged that strongly. So they faced challenges from the Roman world that they inhabited by even other religious communities such as Judaism. The language they used to describe their God and their Lord were words that were used to describe Roman imperial officials. There's really this subversive countercultural movement happening within Christianity at those early stages. That they were saying that Jesus was Lord, not Caesar or not the Roman Empire. And so this letter that Paul writes to this community was written for people with whom their allegiance, their submission, their alignment was to Jesus of Nazareth, the Christ. And it set them at odds with their communities that they lived in, with sometimes their families and sometimes those with whom that they worked with. So where have we been so far in the story of Ephesians in this letter? Where have we journeyed along so far? What are some of the themes that we've already explored? Let me briefly just check over them this morning. We hear in Ephesians 1 about Paul's ongoing prayer and dedication to the church at Ephesus. Chapter 2 talks about the gift of grace that we receive so that no one can boast about their standing with God. We receive this gift so that we can serve each other. Ephesians 3 tells the community at Ephesus that Paul is committed to preaching to the Gentiles, to the non-Jewish community. And Ephesians 4, we hear about the unity within the body of Christ. There are different giftings given: apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. And they're all a part of the body that prepare the community for acts of service. And Paul reminds us in Ephesians 4 to be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other as Christ has forgiven us. Chapter 5 talks about us being imitators of God. Therefore, as we are beloved children of Christ, be imitators of the one whom we serve and love. Our reading today comes from Ephesians chapter 6, right at the end of this letter to the church at Ephesus. This is the concluding remarks of Paul's letter to this church community. And so I'd like to read to you today from Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 20. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in strength and power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, stand firm. Stand therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As for your shoes on your feet, put them on whenever you can proclaim the gospel of peace. And with all these, take the shield of faith, with which you'll be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in the supplicants for all the saints. Pray for me also, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. Well, there we have it, Ephesians 6, 10 to 20, lots to unpack. But as Paul encourages his friends at Ephesus to pray at all times, let's pray together right now. Loving God, as we share in this scripture together today, may something of your wisdom and your truth and your revelation become apparent to us as we wrestle with what Paul is saying to the community of Ephesus. May we receive new insight and new wisdom from you, Father, as we hear with fresh ears these words each day. May the words I speak today, Lord, be from you, and may anything that is not of you simply fall away and be left to one side, Father. I pray these things in your name. Amen. So today I want to highlight just a few things from this reading from Ephesians 6. And the way I'd like to do it is to navigate through three sections with three ideas. And the three ideas I'd like to talk through today are for us to be prepared, to be attentive, and to be generous. And I think Ephesians 6 leads us through these three themes and ideas. So this idea of being prepared, let's start with that. As many of you know, I love to ride my bike. I'm an avid cyclist. It's lots of fun. I really, really enjoy it. But to cycle, you've got to be prepared. And there's actually some clothes you need to wear when you go riding my bike. So each time I go for a ride, I need to put on, first, these. These are my arm warmers. Must have arm warmers when you go cycling, otherwise you freeze. You have a base shirt that goes underneath, also to keep you warm. And when you live in the Dandenongs, you need to wear your cycling jersey, but you can't wear one, you have to wear two. Because if you don't wear two cycling jerseys in the Dandenongs, you freeze. And can't ride without pants on, so I've got to put on my cycling Knicks that have the special soft backside so you don't get a sore bottom when you're riding. I also wear my socks and my gloves. They keep my feet and my hands warm. And lastly, I wear a helmet, because again, I don't want to stack and hurt myself too seriously. But I also forgot, I've got to put on my shoes, my cycling shoes, to keep me on my bike as I'm riding. But perhaps the thing that's most important to remember when I'm cycling is to take this with me. This is my bike pump. If I'm not prepared with my bike pump and I get a flat tire out on the road, I have to walk home. And that happened to me only a few weeks ago. I went out for a ride, I was all prepared, had all my stuff, all my clothes on. I was ready to ride, I was warm, I was safe, had my shoes. Went up the street, up towards the Cuckoo restaurant, which is just near our house, and I got a flat tire. So, oh, that's all right, I'll just change my tire and keep on riding. I had a spare tube in my saddlebag, but I didn't take my bike pump. I was not prepared at all. And so I had to walk home from the Cuckoo back to Sassafras, pushing my bike sadly along the road as it rained on me as well, walking through the mud and water. I was not prepared. Now, in this passage from Ephesians today, Paul uses this military imagery for Christians to be prepared. Now, I find it a bit uncomfortable using military ideas to describe our faith and God, but Paul uses these terms because the military might of Rome was all around the Ephesus community. It was really obvious to them who was in power and what they were doing with that power, that Rome was everywhere. That Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, which was brought about through warfare and combat, was everywhere. And so Paul uses this military idea to talk about the way that the people of faith need to be prepared to get ready when they want to connect and engage with their faith and their spirituality. So he tells them to be prepared with the belt of truth. The belt of truth. And what is the truth that we find within the gospel story of Jesus? The truth that all are welcome in the kingdom of God. the truth that there are neither slaves nor free, males or female, all are one in Christ Jesus. We hear the gospel truth that Jesus would leave the 99 to go and find the one. The gospel truth that the Father waits with open arms for the Son to return from his prodigal ways. This is the belt of truth. That love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, goodness and self-control, the fruits of the Spirit, is the gospel truth that we are called to live out. He also tells the community at Ephesus to put on the breastplate of righteousness, that is, living in harmony with God's desires for a restored world through Jesus, that we share healthy relationships with each other in community, but also with our environment and with our God, that we have a righteousness of the way that we live and inhabit the world. Talks about putting on the shoes of gospel peace, and I love this phrase of putting on the shoes of gospel peace, because we wear our shoes everywhere and our shoes go with us wherever we go. And Paul calls the community at Ephesus, and indeed calls us, to be people who take gospel peace with us on our journey, the gospel peace of bringing good news to people who need to hear good news, that there is transforming wholeness through connection with God through Jesus, that God wants to restore people to community, for justice for the oppressed, and welcome and inclusion. These are the shoes of gospel peace that we can wear. And he tells the community to take up the shield of faith. And faith is also about the faith of the wider community around us. Not only the faith of those who have gone before, but the faith of the community at Boronia and Bayswater. And there's a beautiful reminder of this community of faith in Hebrews 11. Let's hear Hebrews 12, where Paul reminds the community that therefore we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Let us throw everything that entangles and run with perseverance the race marked out for us. And he lists off the many, many heroes of our faith that have been so transformative, influential to our journey as Christians. He encourages the people to put on the helmet of salvation, the idea that we are being restored to God through the ministry of Christ. We are being drawn to God so that we can be transformed into Christ's own image and likeness. And as Paul tells the community at Ephesus earlier, to become imitators of God in the community that they find themselves in. Christ and God's image of love and justice and peace and hope for our world. And finally, to take up the sword of the Spirit, which is God's word. Take up the wisdom that is found within Scripture, that calls us to be read by Scripture as we engage with it. And then we are sent out into the world to be authentic people of faith in our homes and communities and the places where we live and work. This calling from Paul to put on this armor, to be prepared, is not about being ready to attack, but instead it's about being ready to stand firm, to be ready to be strong in the way that we find ourselves, to be secure. And how are we to find this sense of security? Like, we put on this armor of God, we take on these practices and these things that God has taught to us. But we also tap into this sense of being able to stand firm through our prayerfulness. All of this reading from Ephesians today is encircled and couched in the power and influence of prayer in our lives. Paul encourages the community of faith to be fully immersed in the journey of prayer. And this journey is an intentional posture that we are being drawn towards. To be prepared is to be active and intentional, not passive. The words in Paul from our reading in Ephesians 6 contain many verbs, many actions that we are to do. To stand firm, to pray constantly, to put on, to take up, to fasten when I speak. So Paul's words to the community of faith in Ephesus and his words to us is to be prepared and to be active in our spiritual lives. We need to be prepared in truth, righteousness, peace, faith, salvation, and scripture. While we need to be prepared, we also need to be attentive as well. In a way, we prepare ourselves for encountering God by adopting the posture of paying attention. That is, paying attention to what God is up to and where God might be calling us to go. Now, the opposite of being attentive can be really a costly experience for us, not only as people of faith, but people in general. If we're not attentive to things, it can be really costly. We can be disconnected from the calling that God has placed upon our lives and be ill-equipped to serve others in love. Some years ago, I was very inattentive. We were in the process of moving home into a new home. I just concluded a ministry role, which included the use of a house, and we were moving to our new home for the next season of ministry. And as you know, there are lots of things to organize and to sort through and to fix up and to get done when you're moving house. And one of those important things is the good old internet connection. And so I made sure that we were set up with our new internet connection at our old place, and at our new place, sorry, and that our old internet connection was to be cancelled. And we were happy with our provider, so we went with the same company again. It was all sorted, and isn't it great to have internet that's all sorted and working well? Over the next 5 years, we enjoyed stellar internet connection. It was wonderful. And honestly, I didn't pay it much attention at all. You know, when things are working right, when things are going to plan, you often don't even think about them. They just sort of happen and you move on. After about 5 years of serving at that church, we were at our time to move again. And so we were doing a budget about, you know, how are we doing with our money? What are we going to do about it as we go on to our next time of life? And I noticed in our credit card bills that we're paying for the internet around the first time of the month and also at the end of the month. And I thought that's a bit of a strange billing process to have, you know, internet bills come out, you know, the first of the month and then the 25th of the month. That's really weird. And so I went back and thought, I wonder how often that's been happening, and sort of glanced back. Well, it turns out that we had been paying two internet bills for 5 years. And we'd racked up almost $3,000 in extra internet fees, all because I wasn't paying attention. I wasn't attentive to what was going on. Now, it wasn't the provider's fault from some points of view. There was a miscommunication, and so they had assumed that I was just at two different locations, that I was providing internet for two places. But we ended up paying an enormous amount of money extra that we really didn't need to. I simply wasn't paying attention. And when we think about our spiritual lives, about our connection to God, attentiveness is really vital too. Often I can forget to pay attention to the spiritual disciplines that help me be connected to God. And here, what God is up to and hear what God is calling me to. I get distracted, busy, lazy, and I become disconnected and inattentive to God who is moving in my world and in the world around me. In the Gospels, Jesus uses the beautiful metaphor of vine and branches as describing the way for believers to connect him to God, saying like God is the branches and we're the vines coming off. And as we remain connected to God, we can produce fruit. And in the same way, Paul, in this final part of the letter to the Ephesians, is calling for a community who is constantly in communication with God. He writes in Ephesians 6, 18 to 20, "Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray for me also when I speak, so the message may be given to me, and make it known with boldness the mystery of the gospel. With all kinds of prayer and requests." Paul's encouraging the community at Ephesus, and therefore us as well, to be in constant prayer with God. Now, there is nothing that God doesn't want to know about us. That's kind of the paradox of God, that God knows everything. But God also wants desperately for us to connect with God, to be in prayerful communication with God. God desires that we pray for us, for our community of faith, for our neighborhood, for our friends, for our families, for our enemies, for our country, for our world. Nothing is out of the mind of God. God desires that we would be constantly in prayer, being attentive, praying relentlessly, to be alert for opportunities, alert and ready to pray all kinds of prayer. At Right Mentoring, where I also spend some of my time working, we've adopted this posture over the last 12 months of continually asking, God, what are you calling us to do? And we're trying really hard to be constantly asking that question. What is God calling us to do? We're trying to adopt this posture of prayer, to be constantly seeking the wisdom of God about where He's drawing us. And as we pray, as you and I pray all kinds of prayers, this is a place of activity. It's a place of being active. It is a place where we can seek what God is up to, so we can be listening to where God might be calling us. God desires connection with us, and so we need to be responsive and attentive to that relationship. Because as we pray all kinds of prayers, the way opens up where God can offer us clarity about where the gospel needs to be spoken, where it needs to be lived out, where good news needs to be brought. So we've been hearing about being prepared, being attentive. And so now these two actions and attitudes, as we hear and listen to God, draw us into a space of being generous. Because Paul talks about putting on the good news shoes of the gospel of peace. And we could all do with some gospel stories, couldn't we? We could all do with good news in our lives. Well, today you're in luck, because I have got a fantastic gospel story for you. Unfortunately, it begins in a place of hurt and struggle, but I hope you'll hear the good news that comes from this story today. During the bushfire season earlier this year, more than 12.6 million hectares across Australia were burnt. Nearly 3,000 homes were destroyed, and almost 3 billion koalas, kangaroos and other animals were estimated to have been killed or displaced. Images of the blood-red skies of the Bega Valley and thousands of people who have been trapped or evacuated by the Navy were broadcast around the world. In Papua New Guinea's second largest city, Leh, Sheila Harrow saw these pictures on the news and was inspired to take action. On ABC News, Sheila said, "We called out to our Morabian friends to be united in one heart, to give from the heart, to console our neighbour." So she started a bushfire appeal, which saw young people of Papua New Guinea take to the streets with wheelbarrows to collect donations, asking people to give what they could to help Australia who is in need of bushfire relief. Youth groups, churches, businesses, schools and corporate houses all participated to give cash and all kinds of other things. Now, there's roughly 700,000 people who call Lay home. The majority of these people earn less than a dollar a day, with about 32% living below the poverty line. But their financial position did not obstruct their desire to help and give to a community in need. So how much did this small community in Papua New Guinea donate to the bushfire appeal in Australia? Was it $500, $1,500, $10,000? No. The gospel story of this community, the mystery of the gospel, the good news story that they lived out, was a donation of a whopping $60,000. This is the gospel of peace, restoration, hope, and transformation. Wearing the gospel shoes that this community in Papua New Guinea put on and gave so much to help out their neighbour in this community in Australia. What a profound and powerful good news story. These were the gospel shoes of peace. So, we're being called to be prepared in our spiritual lives, putting on the spiritual garments of connectivity to God as God desires to connect with us, to be attentive in praying all kinds of prayers to find out what God is up to in our lives and in our world and to hear where God is calling us. And as we're prepared and as we're attentive, we'll find opportunities to be generous, to be people who bring good news to those around us as we respond to God's movement in our world and God's prompting. As we are prepared by God and attentive in prayer, we will see the opportunities for us to extend generosity to those who we encounter. However, this is my final thought today. Paul is clear that we can't do all this in our own strength or by our own force of effort or by our own will. No. Paul reminds the community at Ephesus and us that we are to find our strength in God. So finally, my friends, may you, in the beautiful words of Paul, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. You see, we walk along this tightrope of experience, don't we? Slowly walking across, holding the balancing pole, looking either side of things that have happened in our lives or happened in our world, and we kind of balance our ways as we walk forward. And potentially looking from side to side at things that are making us struggle can be overwhelming, and we might topple off this rope that we're walking along. These things, there's lots on our minds and lots on our plates that can keep us worried, occupied, stressed and concerned. But as you walk this tightrope of experience that you're having in your world, may you, rather than looking from side to side, look to the horizon of God, seeing the bigger picture beyond the immediate turmoil and struggle, seeing towards where God is calling you and calling us, putting on the garments of God, faith, truth, salvation, peace, righteousness, and scripture. May you walk with your eyes fixed on the horizon of God. May you be prepared in your spiritual life. May you be attentive in prayer, seeking God's counsel and activity in our world. May you be generous as you discover what God is up to in our world. And may you find your strength in God. Friends, I'd like to leave you with a benediction from 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 to 7. For this very reason, You must make every effort to support your faith with goodness, and goodness with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with endurance, and endurance with godliness, and godliness with mutual affection, and mutual affection with love. Go in peace, my friends, and may you have a blessed Sunday and week. Amen.
The sun sets free, moments free and deep. I'm a child of God, your son.
Thanks, Becky.
I didn't know how to start.
Let go!
Okay. Hey, you're a Coldplay.
Because,
Coldplay fan?
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember Parachutes?